Hello, everybody. Welcome back to the SpaZcast. Say hello, everybody.
Hey, guys.
Hey.
Hello. And guys, guess what? We have a really, really awesome episode today. You want to know why?
It's really exciting.
Why?
Because today we have a very special guest.
We do?
Actor Paul Cram. He was featured in the film Dust of War, which we just watched it, and it's a really, really cool film.
I enjoyed it.
I must say. And we have him here live. Hey, Paul.
Hey.
How's it going?
It's going really well. How are you guys doing?
Great.
Good.
Good.
I wish that I didn't have a little bit of a cold, and I would be even more happy.
you sound really, really good to us.
You sound good for a cold.
Oh, you know, I always hear that. People are like, oh, wow, will you call me, like, when you have a cold and talk to me?
I was going to say, you got a second career and a hotline going here.
Yes, but it only works when I have a cold, so, you know. It's that once a year call my phone line.
It's one of those you have to pay every minute kind of thing.
I'm really excited to be chatting with you guys. I feel like I'm in really good company after listening to some of the previous SpaZcasts on YouTube. I'm like, oh my gosh, these guys are geeks and nerds, and I am
indeed
so happy.
Thank you.
Thank you.
That's a very big compliment.
I know,
love
that's pretty awesome how we take that as a compliment. Our younger selves would be like, oh, you jerk. No, we really appreciate you having you on. It's like an honor. You're our first actor. Like this is really, really fun. This is so cool.
Oh, first of many. You guys, I'm sure you'll have tons.
We can only hope. We can only hope. But
I will be the first and last actor that ever appears on your show. I doubt it though.
No, yeah, we'll be fine. Yeah.
But speaking of which, I mean, speaking of acting, so we were wondering, like, what made you get into acting? Like, you know, did you have influences growing up?
Oh my gosh. I was a weird kid growing up. Kind of a geek nerd, so I'm sure you all can relate.
Yeah, absolutely.
And my mother was a little bit concerned that I would become like a social recluse, I think. And she was like, you're going to go and you're going to do some acting to get in front of people so that you're not like that loner person that can't talk. So she had me do some theater and some acting things, and I started to really grow to love it. And I was like, when I got into like junior high and high school, you know, I kept doing like musical theater here and there, which thankfully I didn't really keep doing because now I'm like, should I have said that? There's some wonderful music.
Let's hear that singing voice.
Daisy.
and everybody that loves musical theater, you're awesome and you're nerdy in your way.
Exactly.
I'm nerdy in my way, which is usually not musical theater related. but I got into theater just and I started to do like commercial type stuff locally, and it kind of snowballed from there because I was like, I want to be an actor, and my mom was like, well, how are you going to do that? You know, go for it, do it, figure it out. So I started to do like really bad, cheesy college student films.
Okay.
Everyone's got to start somewhere.
Yeah, exactly.
You got to start somewhere. Yeah. And those were really my training ground, I guess, for a lot of the work that I've done more recently. But, I think that I literally have done so many student films that, the local college where I was, where I grew up. I think every person that has gone through that school has seen my face in every project that they've ever done. So that's kind of how I got started in it. And it wasn't until I did that for a few years before I like started to get like projects. Like the first film I ever worked on in California, was with Eddie Furlong. I don't know if you guys know who that is.
Terminator 2,
yes. And so the first film that I worked on was called Intermedio. And I was ecstatic to be working with, you know, Eddie Furlong. And I about had a heart attack when I found out that the other actress that was in it was Amber Benson. And I was like, gosh, she's that witch from Buffy.
I'm looking around. I think I'm the only real Buffy fan sitting here. And I'm looking around at everyone like, Amber Benson, you guys, come on.
I was like, that Amber sounds Benson, familiar. Amber Buffy, Benson. There it is.
Yeah.
Yes, Amber Benson, the not only the witch from Buffy, also the lesbian witch from Buffy.
The first one ever.
That's true.
In television history.
Yes. So, I mean, even some people that aren't fans of Buffy probably know who that is. So. So yeah, that was like the first film that I had done. It was a horror movie, and it kind of set the tone for a lot of films that I've worked on over the years. Dust of War, the film that we kind of were mentioning that you guys just saw, is a little bit of a different genre because it's more of an action-packed movie. But the fun thing about Dust of War to me, and kind of how it all ties into everything together, is that whole the actor, like Doug Jones, is in Dust of War, and he does tons of like fantasy type stuff, which I think stems into Buffy, and I don't know.
Yeah, we all saw that he was in it, we're like, oh, okay,
ooh, there he is.
I would be really sad if you guys didn't know who Doug Jones was.
Yeah, just hang up right now.
We would be too. Like, click.
He is on my list of like actors that I need to meet him. I actually, even though he worked on Dust of War and I worked on Dust of War, our paths never crossed.
Wow.
Ever.
Oh, man.
That's crazy.
It is crazy. And sadly, because I heard on set, like, everybody was like, oh my gosh, Doug Jones was so just somebody that you should meet. He's just really a cool guy.
Yeah, I can imagine.
Yeah, and I was like, Doug Jones. I was like, I don't know who that is. And then I looked him up online, and I was like, oh, I know who that is. Right. He was in, you know, Pan's Labyrinth, and like, he does all of the crazy, cool prosthetic stuff. And I was like, yeah, I want to meet him. But I was never on set when he was on there. Huh. Since then, though, I've had a few interviews here and there, I think it's just through social media. He's heard my name a few times, and he's actually sent me a couple of notes on Twitter and stuff, and kind of gone back and forth a little bit there. Which to me is like, you know, I'm that geeky guy that's kind of fangirling or fanboying or whatever.
Yeah. And you're like, Abe Sapien just sent me a note on Twitter.
I'm like, oh my gosh. and I'm so glad you guys can relate. So, I'm in good company.
There's a moment, that, I mean, that kind of stuff seems pretty cool, I guess, when you're, you know, get to work with people like that. And like you say, you didn't even get to really meet them, but then
your name's associated in something where his name is. It's just, I think that's really cool.
It adds credibility a lot.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. And it's weird, too, to be asked, like, people are like, oh, you're in that movie with Doug Jones. And they're like, tell me about that. And I'm like, well,
about that.
I heard he's
about
lovely.
Doug. His last name is Jones, and that's about as far as I got.
Yeah. So I'm curious to hear some of your thoughts on Dust of War too. I mean, I don't know. Do you have any? I don't know how much spoiler I should give for my part. My part, I feel like I should tell people, like, with maybe, I don't know how much I want to give away or how much you guys want to give away about my part, but if you blink, you might not see my part.
No way. We knew right away as soon as your part came out. We were like, there he is. Yeah. He's right there.
Yeah. I wanted to ask you something about your big scene there. So I think we should just kind of go for it and spoil it.
I mean,
let's do it.
People should watch it anyways because we all watched it and we enjoyed it. And we thought, I mean, I enjoyed your part even though it was small. I thought it was
very, really good.
Very well
it really was.
Very well played out, but... Go ahead, Bobby, if you want to ask him.
All right. Well, as you're watching your scene unfold and, you know, you find yourself in a sticky situation there for a minute, but when you yell and you're kind of like, are you guys kidding me, as they're walking away from you, and it seemed to me that the way you played it kind of hinted at the relationship that that group of people had and that they're not just a band that came together yesterday, and it kind of seemed like... You were having your back turned on you by your friends. I was just wondering, like, when you pick a role and you choose what part you want to do like that, do you come up with, you know, a history for these characters or a backstory for yourself? Or was it given to you? Or do you just kind of take what you're given and then roll with it?
All of that, yes.
D, all the above.
And I say all of that just because it kind of everything that you've just said has happened in several different ways on different projects. You know, sometimes a director will come up to me and they'll be like, you know, they'll kind of give me some of a backstory. And sometimes a director will give me absolutely nothing and just rely on me to make that up.
Wow.
On this project, there was a lot of, it wasn't like the director sat us all down and said, you know, you guys have been, you know, doing this for years or months or anything like that. But there was a certain camaraderie that just kind of started to happen as we were getting ready to shoot. And it just kind of felt right. So it wasn't like, what I'm trying to say too, like I didn't write out like my 12-page backstory for this character.
Right.
and I have done that in the past on certain parts that had even less lines. I don't know. I think that there's some parts that for me to really wrap my brain around it, it requires me to figure all that stuff out. But this part, I don't know. The relationships between everybody they were really fun. I just have to say, like, the actor that in that scene where I'm, you know, screaming at them, like, are you kidding me? The actor Bates Wilder, the you'll probably remember him because he had the funky eye.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
he General. Was so fun to, like, he kept throwing things at me. Like, he improvised some of that scene, just some of the lines. And he kind of, that part with the rock, I don't know. We didn't explain any of this. The listeners have no idea what we're talking about.
Yeah,
I
don't know. We can give away.
Well, that
but
goes
we
back
yeah.
to like, if
I was trying
give
to step
away.
Around it, but step yeah. around it, get it? No yeah. pun intended.
Well,
oh, there it is. Okay. There's the first
the part
pun of this
the rock
podcast.
Is that wasn't in the script. And Bates was kind of like, you know, it would be really funny. And he kind of motioned to one of the other actors. And he's like, pick up that rock and like give it to him during the scene. And so we just kind of rolled with some of that kind of stuff. And I think all of that, just being willing to play, really helped. It helped me, and I think it helped a lot of the other people too, just in the short amount of time, really seemed like we did have a rapport, and it made it so much more fun. Like, I love being an actor because I love that play, you know,
right.
when I'm acting and it feels like we're playing, that is so rewarding.
Yeah, I mean, I can imagine, like you said, and if everybody around you is making it fun and, you know, I guess more easier to play your part too.
It's comforting.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And that's what I always wonder about watching these things, because it's always like, to me, acting is like what I would aspire to do if I wasn't shy. But like, I always think about like character, like what were the characters doing before you're seeing them in that moment? And it just, you know,
right.
It's fascinating
right.
to me.
Right. Oh, absolutely. Well, and even if you're shy, you too could become an actor.
A voice actor, perhaps.
A voice actor. Yeah, right.
Well, and I also, too, like during that scene, and the film, in the that other scene, too, when I was in the water, which was really quick. It's funny because both of the scenes, like my character has a certain level of fear. and there was just some really good motivators for myself. I grew up in the Midwest. I don't know where you all have grown up. Are you all from the East Coast?
Yep, all
yeah.
from
sure.
all from Baltimore, really, or in the Baltimore, Maryland area.
Well, booyah. Like, hello, Baltimore. I grew up in the Midwest, so I'm used to, like, you know, a little bit of a cooler climate, you know, and used to like the great outdoors. But Dust of War filmed in South Dakota, which again, like, I pride myself on being, you know, the Midwesterner. I know the Midwest, you know, I'm good.
You're like walking, yeah. I got this. I got the geography.
I got the exactly. And so I get, you know, on set, and all of a sudden, you know, somebody on set was like, oh, Paul, you're new. You need to go and talk to the snake wrangler. And I thought that they were kidding. Like, oh, let's like, you know, let's pull a joke on the new guy.
Yeah.
And I started laughing. I was like, that's really good, you know. And the girl, she's like, why? No, I'm not kidding. I'm serious. Like, you need to go and talk to the snake wrangler with the other group of people that are new.
You're like, oh,
and
crap.
So we
what
circle up in a circle and I'm standing there and I was just like, this is really interesting. I don't know what a snake wrangler is. Like, what does this person do? You know? And, cause I've heard of like wranglers, like, I don't know, like a cow wrangler, you know what I mean?
Right. Yeah. Just poke the snakes with a stick.
Yeah. Is this a guy that just like,
get over there,
a girl that just gets all the snakes in a pen?
Yeah. Well, you just kind of hit the nail on the head there. Yes.
Yeah. They're not going to like start nunchucking them around or anything like that.
Her job, like literally, like she had like thigh high leather boots on. And I watched her as she would walk across the sets that we were going to be filming on. And she had like a gunny sack, which when she started on one side of the set was empty and it was just a loose gunny sack, kind of like a pillowcase. And by the time she'd walk to the other side of the set, it was like weighted and she was like picking up rattlesnakes and putting them in this gunny sack. And I was like, oh, that is really frightening.
Bag of snakes.
Yeah, I'm good. Yeah.
And I had this overwhelming thought in my head though, and I was like, what does she do with them later? Like, does she bring them home? Like, I had this
like
visual,
a cat
like,
lady, but it's a snake lady.
Yeah,
like,
exactly.
It's a snake lady, and she would like put them in an aquarium that's like at the foot of her bed, and she'd give them names like from like gaming, like, you know, like call one of them like Sir Lancelot, and like I don't know, like. It's just crazy the weird things that go through your brain when you're scared. but anyway, no. So they literally had like snake camp, like training, like how to handle yourself on set. And she's telling me, she's like, okay. And me and a group of other guys that were on set that day, she's like, you know, we are in South Dakota. There's tons of rattlesnakes here. You guys, what you need to do is, you know, walk single file to set, you know, because our base camp was actually separate from a lot of the filming locations. So we had to walk like single file through these fields to get to set. And I was, and basically, I don't know about you guys, but I don't like snakes. Like, if it hasn't become apparent to you yet from me telling you these stories. And she's like, if you see a snake, a rattlesnake, or you hear one, just stop moving and scream snake and I will come and handle, I'll take care of it.
Oh, okay. So don't.
I feel like exclaiming something like that would be the opposite of what you want
to
do.
So just wait for it to bite you.
Yeah, basically.
And I was just thinking in my head, I was like, if I hear a rattlesnake, yes, I am going to scream snake, but I don't think I'm going to stop. Like,
yeah, running away.
Just pointing at it like, it's right there. It's right.
It just bites your finger.
Oh, here it is.
And I think, exactly. And I think she could tell. I think she could read my mind because she looked at me and she goes, oh, and by the way, if you do run, you'll probably end up running through like a nest of rattlesnakes, so it's probably in your best interest not to run. Oh,
sounds like a nice place you filmed at, Paul.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, that's what I thought too. And the icing on top of this cake.
The snake cake.
The snake cake is that after all of this talk of rattlesnakes, she's like, "Oh, and by the way, there's also these snakes here that I should probably mention too. You know, rattlesnakes are like these are like rattlesnakes are and literally she used these words. She's like, "Rattlesnakes are like honeybees. They won't sting you unless they're like really provoked. Like they'll just they're just like honeybees." And I looked at her and I was like, "Rattlesnakes are not like honeybees, honey."
Yeah. Yeah, I call bullshit.
Gonna go with no.
Well, Wrangler is this?
Yeah, yeah. It befuddled my brain a little bit when she started to describe them as honeybees, but I understood what she was saying. She was just trying to explain to you, like, they will actually, instead of being confrontational, they actually will try to get away from you instead of bite you, if they could.
Like, I would hope.
Yeah.
For the sake of everyone.
If they're all the same.
but the cherry on top of this proverbial snake cake is that there's other snakes out there, too, that are called bull snakes. And do you guys have bull snakes there on the East Coast?
We have, like, black snakes garden and, snakes. Like, a copperhead might give you some pain for, like, an hour until you get to the hospital.
Yeah, we don't have much, yeah.
So, no. We have spiders.
You have spiders, though. Hopefully you have something that's poisonous that could kill you if it bites you, right? Right.
Yeah, we can find some.
Yeah. I don't know if there's any wranglers for that, though.
No.
I don't believe so.
Oh, my gosh.
Spider wrangler?
A spider wrangler? Could you imagine?
Get the box.
If you miss, just turn and run. That's when you turn and run.
Well, where rattlesnakes are, this is like a snake tutorial. I'm like giving you guys a snake tutorial.
We're all learning a lot here.
You never know. If we're in the Midwest, you know.
Thank you for bearing with me, because this is all motivation for what my character was thinking while I was acting. So these bull snakes, whereas rattlesnakes are like soft and gentle honeybees, bull snakes are aggressive little mofos, and they will chase you down and climb up your leg. Yeah. And the way that they are aggressive is that they don't bite, but they're stranglers. So they will like wrap themselves around
you. So that's just as good.
They'll just crawl up your body hard and strangle you.
Yeah, instead.
Yeah. And I already have a fear of bull snakes because my older sister, she always would tell me the story growing up that, you know, she was out in the field once because we grew up on the country, and this bull snake like chased her, and she always would just talk about how mortifying it was because it moved so fast.
Wow. You wouldn't think that they would move quick, I guess.
So anyway, we're filming out in these fields, and I'm just thinking to myself, like, okay, let me get this straight. If I hear a rattler, I'm not supposed to run. And if I see a bull snake, I'm confused on if I'm supposed to not run or run, because there could potentially be like a nest of rattlers.
This is not a win-win at all.
But you know, the snake wrangler, she's like, Paul, by the way, we have not just one, but we have two anti-venom shots if we need them.
Well, that's a good backup to have.
Yeah.
And I was like,
how many people were
great
on set that day?
There was a lot. They never had to use it. Nobody got bit. Nobody got hurt. It was very good. But so when I was filming my scene, I did actually let some of that seep into my character, which is just that fear of snakes, I guess.
Well, that's good that it influenced you at least a little bit.
Yeah, exactly.
Took some of it in the heart.
Over the fear of getting shot or something.
Oh, my gosh, yeah. Yeah, well, it's actually interesting how they did that too. Like, I was actually... that gun was never really pointed directly at me or anything, so it was all good. It was all good.
That's good.
Cool.
Yeah. Yeah. I have to give a shout out to the director for that scene, actually. You know the scene where I get the gun pointed at me and I'm in the water?
Yeah.
Yeah.
He actually climbed into the water with me.
I got a little wet and wild.
Yeah.
Good for him.
Yeah. Which I thought was really nice. I always think it's nice when a director, instead of just being like,
hey,
you
do this. Yeah.
Get
jump
in there
now.
Yeah.
You know, he dripped down to his skivvies and jumped into the dirty water that had snakes too. So,
well, that's cool. Yeah, I agree. I think that's nice if a director can, you know, help you with the part, not just say, hey, point fingers and do that and
get,
go.
Get in there.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Well, and he actually stood in front of the gun just to show me what all was going to have happen and everything, and had it pointed at him first. And again,
I'm
going to
demonstrate getting shot.
Nobody was shot, but it was, he's a director that I hope to work with again. Yeah. Andrew Kightlinger. So we'll see what happens.
That's awesome.
Hopefully maybe though, somewhere where there's, I don't know, no snakes.
Alaska.
Yeah, come on out to Baltimore. There you go. Maybe a homeless guy or two, but that's
about it. That's about all we got.
Yeah.
Baltimore. For some reason, I'm having a blank. Are you guys, does Baltimore have water on one
side?
Yeah,
we're right on the Chesapeake Bay.
Oh, beautiful. Okay.
So, yeah, it actually can be beautiful.
Some parts are.
Other parts, you know.
What's your baseball team there?
The Orioles.
Orioles.
The Orioles, yes.
Yep.
Yes. Excellent.
End of the postseason.
Woo! Orioles are going to the show, but that's...
that's besides...
That's a whole other episode on that topic.
We're just excited because it's been a while.
It's been like 17 years, so we're pretty excited.
Well, it's been a while for... I grew up in Minnesota, too, so... Hey, yeah, it's been a while for the Twins, too.
Hey, Paul, I wanted to ask you... This is Garrett. So, going back to that scene of yours... So how many takes did that take you? Was it like a one and done, or did you just do how many?
I wish I could say that it was one and done. Yeah. actually, I don't. It was really fun. I loved it. Once I started to lose my voice a little bit from all the screaming, but
yeah.
But some of that I think added. It was good, but
yeah, because I enjoyed. Like I said, I thought you acted that part very well for, you know, considering you had to act like you know. We're in a really shitty situation without giving anything away.
Imminent
yeah.
death.
And you know, I think we all commented here how you, I guess the take that they kept with the spit flying out of your mouth.
It was perfect. Yeah.
Like, wonder if he did that? That he was dealing with a wad of spit in his mouth, or did he like?
Oh, the spit thing only happened once.
Okay, so it was the take that they used.
And that was the take that they used. Very and, you nice. Know, I find that a lot of the films that I've worked on, Dust of War included, it's usually those little things like that you just can't really fake very well.
Right, yeah.
Yeah.
I think it made it more effective, too, because I think that's why it worked really well, too, because... Just that little wad of spit. It just.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. That was real spit. That was not the only CGI.
Yeah, not the CGI spit.
And, yeah. Oh my gosh, that's funny. It reminds me. I did a film down in Florida, and my character was being held up by this super hot Swedish actress, and she had a gun to my head, and they used the take where my tongue got all twisted and tied for real. But I mean, I don't know. What guy wouldn't get all tongue tied if there's a, you know, a Swedish model? Like, anyway.
You dog.
I know.
So you're really well. You're really good in the moment. You just
go with it.
Yeah, exactly.
He's a guy
I mean?
That knows how to go with the flow.
Yeah.
You try to go with the flow. But what was so hard, challenging was that they had to do ADR, which is, you know, voice over later in the studio, and they were like, well, you know, you flubbed all of your lines, like you just have to do that again.
Just flub them again. on purpose this time though.
I was like, but I did that on accident, like my tongue really was tied up, like this wasn't fake. and you know, 50 takes later, it was apparent that I was like, wow, he really was not acting.
Like, yeah, okay, so he's for real in this.
Yeah but yeah, no, Dust of War, they did we did several takes on that, but yeah, they ended up using that one that where the spit comes flying out of my mouth.
Nice. Well, that's cool to hear, because that's I think that made it really
definitely
effective.
Added to it.
Yeah
it definitely made me cringe when I was like, oh, that's so gross.
Like, ooh, that was a lot. Oh man, that was a lot. No, going back to your rattlesnake story, I was curious because it seemed like in the movie there was just everybody was just eating nothing but rattlesnake. Did anybody actually eat real rattlesnake on the set? Is it a delicacy in South Dakota?
Not when I was there. When I was there, nobody ate any rattlesnake. although I'm pretty sure that I'm pretty sure that several people from the set have, if not on that set, ate rattlesnake, they have at some point.
It's a real dish.
It is.
I mean you can go eat rattlesnake.
Have any of you, it sounds like none of you have ate rattlesnake before.
No.
Not
okay.
I'm most exotic I've gone, I think, is alligator. So
Wow. Well, I was actually working on the East Coast recently. I was in Maine, and I did not eat rattlesnake. But you know what I did have for the first time ever was moose balls.
Moose balls.
Okay. I was thinking.
I thought you were going to say lobster.
Yeah, maybe some lobster.
Yeah, we were hoping maybe lobster balls.
Cape Cod oysters, huh?
Actually, lobster was also on the list of the first things that I've tried. But
the
for
moose
some
balls
reason,
were the appetizers, well, I guess.
Well, are more interested in the moose balls, but I don't know why that is. But
so, what do they taste like? I guess that's got to be the next question of this.
Did you have some sauce
ball
to go with it or something?
Get some powder on there.
I will explain. I suppose I should say I did not eat moose testicles.
I ate
moose balls, as in
like meat, moose, just like
moose meat that has been ground up and made into a ball, much like a Italian meatball.
Okay, I got you.
Okay, I think we were all under the impression you were eating some testes out there.
It's still pretty exotic.
I mean, let's face it.
All of us and the listeners were like, oh, he ate real testicles.
Oh, I love it. And this is the part that you're going to edit out so that they still continue to think that I ate.
Yes, exactly. The explanation's gone, so.
Yep.
That would be excellent. Oh, my gosh. Oh, yeah. And moose balls, I have to say, moose, like I said before, I come from the Midwest, you know, so I've had things like deer and venison. Moose, though, it's that funky thing where it's just like people were asking me, like, what does it taste like? And I was like, it's like chicken because there's no way to really describe it. It's like it's that indefinable. It's like it's a meat, but you just don't know how to describe the flavor. I was like, it's gamey, yeah. But it's not like gamey like anything I've ever had before. So
that's how it was for alligator for me. I was like, when the people asked me, it was like bland chicken. Like, it actually needed some sauce. Like, it needed something. You couldn't just eat alligator and be like, oh, this is really good.
Could use a little bit of barbecue sauce.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. I can eat almost any meat with barbecue sauce.
Nice.
Give me some lobster barbecue sauce. It'll be great.
So, Paul, as you know, since you've been listening to our show, we go off on tangents a lot. So back to Dust of War. I was just wondering, how long did it take to shoot the movie?
How long did it take to shoot the movie? I actually don't know how to answer that question. I can tell you how long it took to shoot my part.
Okay, sure.
My part took 2 days to shoot. And that would be my part. So I was in and out of South Dakota really quickly. If I had to guess how long it took to shoot Dust of War, I would have to say probably somewhere around a month.
Okay. Wow.
Was it all shot in South Dakota?
I believe it was. Yes.
Okay. So that, I guess that makes it easier to get it all done in a shorter time.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I, coming from Minnesota, like I was blown away with like how beautiful the prairies are in South Dakota, because we don't really have quite that topography in Minnesota. Minnesota's a little bit way more green and more, I want to say rugged, but I don't know if that's the right word. but Dust of War, I mean, it just has those sweeping vistas that are just so beautiful. Like, yeah.
I agree.
It's just a bummer that they have snakes.
Yeah, the only downfall, I guess, is South Dakota.
Yeah.
I mean, yeah, like, I would have to say that another thing about the movie that I really enjoyed was really just all around how it was filmed, like how it was shot. Like the cinematography was really, really cool.
I agree.
And I mean, that and like when I watched the movie, I never really would have guessed that it was South Dakota. You know, I thought it was like, I don't know, like somewhere in Nevada or like Arizona, because it was just like that desert kind of feel to it. So it was like surprising. And you find out, well, South Dakota? Really? That's pretty awesome.
It was shot very well.
I agree. And I loved how it had sort of a, like I loved when I was going through wardrobe and they were kind of putting together my costume and the costume designers and the wardrobe people were, you know, mixing and matching. And I always reference, like, I'm like, it's to me, like the look that they achieved is so crazy cool. Because it melds, like in my brain, it's like the Civil War and like something you'd see like more modern day, like in Saudi Arabia. Like Desert Storm meets the Civil War or something like that. You know what I mean? Where it's just like, huh, what is that? Which I thought was really cool. I don't know. A lot of times when I'm talking to people about Dust of War 2, the Mad Max comes up.
That's a good.
I think when I saw the trailer, it kind of reminded me of that too.
That's what. Yeah, when me and Garrett first saw, we looked at each other and we're like, "Oh, it's gonna be like Mad Max." But
yeah, and there is some. You know, I think there's some definite nods to that within the film. Which I think
that's just like the go-to post-apocalyptic comparison.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah. Definitely.
Yeah. Well, and I mean, I don't know. Did you guys recognize Mel Gibson in the film? I'm kidding. Totally kidding.
Yeah, he was right there.
He was that guy in the cage. In the,
the guy. No, and actually, and I was so excited too. And again, like I the only actor that I worked on set with was Gary Graham. who I was glad to kind of sit and chat with him for a while, which is funny that he and I were chatting because he and I were never in any scenes together. But Gary Graham, for some of your listeners probably wouldn't recognize him from that. He was on that TV show Alien Nation in the early 90s. And I'm going to start naming some of the people that were in Dust of War other than myself. Doug Jones, obviously, we've talked about him. And then Tony Todd.
Tony Todd.
The Candyman.
The man from my nightmares.
When I heard too, like, that Tony Todd is, whereas, like, Doug Jones is just, like, super, how would I describe it? Like, I heard that, Tony Todd and Doug Jones would be, you'd want to meet both of them. And for similar yet wildly different reasons, like, Doug Jones is, like, just super kind and nice, and so is Tony Todd. But Tony Todd, like, I guess they're, you know, the scene where he lights the drink, that was his idea.
That's badass.
If that gives any insight into,
yeah, so yeah, I could see him. I could imagine that they're both different types of people to
meet. So so I'm talking all about them, and I've never met either of them. So.
I don't think I could meet Tony Todd. I'd have to, like, run the other way. He was, like, the first horror movie that really messed me up was Candyman and his hook.
Plus, he looks massive.
Plus, he looks gigantic.
And the voice. I mean, it's the voice, too. The voice is just
terrifying.
I'd have to be like, listen, Tony, I know you're a nice guy, but I got to get away from you now.
Look, Tony, I know that we're supposed to work together, but I can't.
Yeah, I just can't do it, man.
Oh, that's awesome. That is awesome. Yeah, Candyman. Yeah. Maybe I would have been really scared. I don't know.
I want to, Paul, I want to say that, you said, well, this is a movie that plays on the Sci-Fi Channel, correct?
This is a movie, I believe that it is headed there. I don't know if it's playing there right now, but I do know that it's on. It came out in June, so it has not been out super, super long. Okay. It came out to, I think it's like Amazon, and I think you could even rent it like on YouTube if you know where to find that kind of stuff.
Okay.
I
was going to say
like
that
it
was
somewhere.
I felt when I watched it, and it was like, you know, just kept watching. And the time kept going by. I was like, wow, it doesn't remind me of a Sci-Fi Channel movie, not like, you know, the Sharknadoes out there that they're all great, but they're great for a funny, stupid reason. And, you know, I didn't find any of that in this movie of like the cheesiness or the, you know, bad CGI or anything like that. I actually like took it seriously the whole time because that's like, when you mentioned, you know, you'd done sci-fi films and all that kind of stuff, I figured that it was going to play, you know, on the Sci-Fi Channel. And if it does, I think it's a great spot for it.
I think it'd do well on the Sci-Fi Channel, definitely.
I thought it was, you know, didn't compare to anything on there. And I thought, like, I think we all agreed that the, you know, cinematography was, I thought, great.
Oh, it was
really
so
great.
Good. It was really,
and all
really
the
good.
Shots that was composed in some parts, I thought they were fantastic. So,
I agree.
So you say, like, I guess for right now, it's like on Amazon and like YouTube, you know.
It's on Amazon. It's on YouTube. I feel like it's everywhere that you can rent stuff. I think you can even, if you have your Xbox or however people do that. I'm so not geeky in some ways.
Yeah.
My little brother will probably kick me later. He'll be like, dude, like, you don't know how to do that. But yeah, you can. That's where you can find it. I think the easiest place. I just keep telling people I'm like Amazon because it's so easy to get to.
Right.
But yeah, I could see this winding up on the Sci-Fi Channel. Absolutely. Intermedia wound up on the Sci-Fi Channel. it still plays on the Sci-Fi Channel, which is interesting to me because it's not sci-fi at all. The Intermedia movie with Eddie Furlong has no sci-fi in it whatsoever.
Well, maybe it's just, you
that's
know,
still pretty sweet.
Yeah, that is awesome. Like, you know, sci-fi can, you know, I guess whatever they want.
The hell they want, yeah.
Well, and right. Absolutely. And play more movies that I'm in, please,
exactly,
Sci-Fi Channel. Yes.
It's exposure for you, so.
Well, I don't want to deviate too much from Dust of War here, but, and I'm not positive that your IMDb is accurate or not, but I do see you got a bunch of things upcoming. I mean, it shows here that you have 5 films, 3 completed, 1 in post, and you're filming 1 currently. Is that all accurate?
That is accurate, yes.
So you're filming now.
That's great. Wow. Staying busy, huh?
I am definitely staying busy, which is, let's knock on wood. I need to find a block of wood. yeah, it's interesting. It feels like it's been a really busy year. Really busy start of the year too. There was actually, I'll tell you guys because I already kind of mentioned a little bit about it. I'm really excited about a film that finished filming. It's in post production. It's called Anniversary, and that's the movie that I shot on the East Coast earlier this year.
Oh, cool!
In Maine, yeah. Moose and balls, yeah. I'm excited about that one because it is a. It's dramatic, but it's a horror movie, but it's also got like some heart to it. And it's beautiful. I saw some of the footage. I would actually say that there's something really similar to it to Dust of War, where it just has, you know, these sweeping, just panoramic, you know, shots that you could frame and put in your living room if you like that kind of stuff.
I'm already interested. Yeah,
I'm already there.
Yeah, yeah. And on top of that, my character, I actually have more than a few lines in that one. Anniversary, I'm actually one of the 3 leads. So.
Hey, that's awesome. Congrats.
Yeah, thank you. So I'm excited about that. And I'm also excited because the character that I play in that film, I'm one of the few people that sees these really creepy creatures that crawl around at night. So,
oh god,
I'm sold.
Yeah, we're so there.
Creepy crawlers.
I'll buy the ticket.
Yeah, I don't know. Are you guys fans of like horror movies?
Or?
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Well, I mean, I got the impression that you were because everybody kept referencing Tony Todd. So I was like, yeah. And you guys know who Doug Jones is.
Yeah.
And,
right. Yeah.
We're all huge horror sci-fi. I mean, movie fans in general.
Yeah, really. Yeah, a lot of different things.
Me and a couple friends of mine like track down low-budget horror movies. We just have you ever heard of? Oh my god, I can't even remember the name of it. I really didn't even. The Lord of Tears.
The Lord of Tears. No.
Lord of Tears. It's a little low-budget horror movie out of England, and we had to actually contact the director of it and PayPal him directly to have him send his film to us. Yeah, well, I'm all over the low budget horror stuff.
That is so awesome, actually. Oh my gosh, I have a stack of DVDs I could mail you that I.
Well, there you go.
We gotta become pals, Paul.
There you go.
No, that's excellent. That is excellent. Yeah. So yes, if people check out my IMDb and are curious about any of those, yeah, those are pretty accurate. And let me see here. Yeah, actually, Anniversary is not the one that I did out in Maine. Is not going to probably be done for about a year and a half or so.
Oh, come on.
but if you're looking on there too, Kill Game,
where
I play the role of Donald Buckley, that should be out this fall. And that has, I don't know how they're going to release that yet. I don't know if they know exactly, but I think it's going to be just coming streaming out. But I don't know. It played at a couple of film festivals too, like Comic-Con.
Nice.
So did, you know what? Dust of War played at Comic-Con too. That's
awesome.
Wow. That's really cool.
Yeah. Yeah. But Kill Game is a fun little movie that shot in Chicago. And what I thought was kind of fun about it is it's such a typical, I hate to use the word typical, but you know what I mean, typical slasher movie where, you know, you've got a bunch of beautiful teenagers that, you know, they may or may not
all die.
Cavort.
They may or may not all
get naked and run away.
You've got it.
We knew it.
But I dig some of those sometimes where it's just like, you know what? I don't have to think about this too much. It's pretty straightforward. Yeah. So, yeah.
Well, you'll have to let us know when you figure out how they're being released and everything. And
yeah, no, absolutely. I will shamelessly contact you again or, you know, be in touch and absolutely.
Awesome. Well, Paul, it was just so awesome to have you on. I just have one more question for you. There was an episode that we did. It was actually the second episode. Where all of us were talking about some of our favorite like video games and stuff like that growing up. Yes. Just out of curiosity, did you have one? Did you have one or currently have a favorite
Spyro.
Video game?
Spyro.
Oh,
Spyro.
Nice.
There you go. Hell yeah. That's a good name, Bob. I love it.
Dragon.
That's right. That is right. Spyro the Dragon would be my absolute. The second after that one would probably be. Did any of you ever play Myst?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. Okay. Well, that would be like my second.
I lost a lot of time to Myst.
I too lost a lot of time to Myst. but definitely Spyro and then Myst, and not the Myst, like not the ones where they started to add in like a lot of movement. Like, I mean, like the classic Myst.
Yeah. Myst 1.
Yep. Myst 1.
That was the one.
Awesome. Well, Paul, thank you so much again for being on the show. It was just a pleasure.
Yeah, it was fantastic.
Oh, it's so good to chat with all of you guys, and thanks for listening to all of my snake stories.
Oh yeah, well we'll definitely promote the Dust of War and everything else that you know that's coming out with you and you know your lead roles that are coming up here. And
definitely,
yeah, you got to come back on the show when they come out.
Totally. I'm excited. Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. Hopefully, they come out sooner than later. But
yeah, and feel free. Yeah. I don't know if you're friends with us on Facebook, but if you want to post on there or you know our Instagram, I don't know. How did you find us?
You guys liked something about me on Twitter, and then I kind of was digging around Twitter or Facebook or something that I had posted. And then I was like, well, who is this? And then I started to dig in. Maybe it was on YouTube. I don't know. And then I started to dig into it, and I was like, well, these guys are kind of cool.
Awesome.
Oh, we're cool.
We're kind of cool.
Yeah.
We'll take
it
from actor Paul Cram.
and so then that's how I started to come across your stuff, and I was like, I would love to talk to these guys. So
good stuff.
Well, we would love to talk to you again as soon as we possibly can. So. Yeah.
Excellent. Same. So let's do it. Let's do it.
Sweet.
Sounds great.
All right, Paul. Awesome. Thank you so much again.
You are so welcome.
So that was actor Paul Cram, again, from the film Dust of War. If you guys get a chance, definitely check it out.
Great guy.
Definitely really, really cool dude. So, Paul, thanks again. And guys, everybody listening.
I watched it at work today.
And everybody listening, thank you so much yet again. Tune in next week.
Yep.
See you.
Thanks, guys.
Bye.